graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Elmer Kelton's Bowie's Mine, Book 3 of the Buckaloo Family Trilogy, Texas Sunrise. Narrated by Terence Aselford, with performances by Bobby Aselford, Nora Achrati, Thomas Keegan, Bradley Smith, Andy Clemence, J.W. Rone, Eric Messner, Richard Rohan, David Jourdan, Michael Glenn, Patrick Bussink, Amanda Forstrom, Kimberly Gilbert, Catherine Aselford, Nathanial Perry, Gary Tells, Colleen Delany, Dylan Lynch, Yazmin Tuazon, Scott McCormick, Nanette Savard, Christopher Walker, Rose Elizabeth Supan, and Mort Shelby. Bowie's Mine, Texas Sunrise, Book 3. His name was Daniel Provost, and it was the time of the Texas Republic. Once, years ago, he had heard Sam Houston's twin sister cannons at San Jacinto, and from sanctuary beyond the rain-flooded bayous, he had watched smoke rise over the battlefield. He had been a boy then, too young to fight. Now the 1840s were well along, and he was a young man, but no adventure was left. Modern times and civilization seemed to have stilled it forever. His world was restricted to the narrow confines of Hopeful Valley, along the Colorado River in what was considered western Texas, and it was seen mostly over the narrow, pinched rump of a lazy brown mule. The man riding the bay horse and leading three pack mules was the first stranger Daniel had seen in 3 months. He leaned to pull against the leather reins looped around the back of his neck and let the heavy wooden plow ease over as he watched the horseman slowly work his way down the gentle hill toward the field. The man wore buckskin and an old Mexican sombrero that had seen too many rains and too much sun. Daniel watched in silent curiosity as the man reined up at the end of the plowed rows and raised his hand in peace. The man's long rifle lay across his lap, but Daniel saw no threat in it. The face looked friendly enough, what he could see of it through a considerable growth of brown whiskers.
Stand there, Hezekiah.
Daniel needlessly admonished the mule. Anytime Hez was given a chance to halt, he wouldn't lift a foot until he had to. Daniel slipped out of the reins and trudged across the rows, studying the man as he went.
How do? Anything I can do for you?
The man looked around, and Daniel sensed he was searching for a sign of a rifle. Daniel had none.
I come in peace, brother, as any good honorable man.
A benign smile shone through the whiskers, and Daniel could see this was a young man, possibly 30, maybe even less.
Name's Milo Seldom. Is that water you got in yonder jug, or something stronger?
Water.
Daniel fetched the canvas-wrapped jug from where it hung in the benevolent shade of a huge and ancient live oak. Seldom tipped the jug off his shoulder in the style of a man drinking whiskey.
Oh, sure am obliged.
He wiped his sleeve across his mouth and handed back the jug.
Mighty good water. Many a place I've been, folks will offer you hard liquor first off. Glad to see that y'all here have got a bent toward religion.
Ain't religion exactly. Whiskey and hot sun and hard work don't mix too good. My name's Daniel Provost. You come a long ways?
A long ways. Still got a far piece to go. I seen a cabin is atop the hill. You got a wife there and family?
Ain't married. I live with my folks.
Seen a deer back yonder a mile or so. If I was gonna go fetch it in, reckon the woman of the house might see fit to share victuals with the lonesome hungry stranger?
You don't need to bring nothing to be welcome at the Provost house.
But Daniel reckoned it wouldn't hurt any. The men folks had been too busy with the planting to fetch fresh meat.
I always like to bring more than I take away. These folks thinking good old Milo Seldom. If you kindly see after my pack mules a bit, I'd go see after that there deer.
Daniel took the lead rope and led the mules to the tree where he had kept the water jug. Knowing mules, he didn't put the jug back where it had been. Hezekiah moved his head interestedly, looking at the pack mules and watching Seldom ride away on his bay horse. But he showed no inclination to move his feet. He never did until he was forced to. Daniel studied the bulging packs and tried to make out the vague aroma that came from them. It was somehow familiar, but mixed with the strong mule sweat, it was too evasive to identify. Curiosity nagged at him, and when the stranger was out of sight, Daniel went so far as to put a hand on the rope that held one canvas bundle. But he changed his mind. A man didn't poke where he had no business. He walked back to Hez and put him and the plow into service again, his mind on the stranger rather than on the job. He sensed that Seldom had come from far-off places, and maybe was headed for far-off places Daniel hadn't even heard of, let alone seen. Daniel had no fear of work, and the plow handle fit his hands, and he had often thought it would be good just once before he settled finally into harness and took up wife and land of his own to go out and see what lay beyond the hills that rimmed this valley, to see the lands from which the few travelers came. Perhaps even to see the mysterious western country from which the Comanches used to materialize wraith-like, to strike suddenly and kill and burn and fade away again. He sensed that Milo Seldom had been to these places, some of them anyway, and that his hands were not made for the plow. Briefly, he envied the man, as he had envied a couple of men in Hopeful Valley who had been in the thick of the battle with Sam Houston. They never talked about it much. They talked much easier about crops and horses and cattle and the like. Maybe that was the way of it for most men. One big adventure, and they were ready to settle down for a quiet, steady life of hard work. Trouble was, Daniel hadn't had his adventure yet. He sensed that Milo Seldom was a man given entirely to the kind of experience Daniel hungered after. There was no second shot from the man's long rifle, which did not surprise Daniel. He suspected those keen gray eyes needed but one chance to look down the barrel and over the sights. By the time the stranger came back, the deer properly gutted and draped behind his saddle, Daniel had finished at the end of a row. The sun was still an hour high, but on such an occasion as having a stranger call, he doubted that anybody could fault him for calling it a day. He unhitched Hezekiah from the plow, climbed up onto his bare back, and rode to the tree where the pack mules were tied. The stranger sat idly, pitching up a flattened chunk of lead and catching it in his hand. It was the ball which he had used to kill the deer. Lead was not to be wasted, and a hunter usually made every effort to retrieve it and melt it to be poured for another day, another deer.
You just shot once.
Poverty makes a man a good shot. Takes coin for powder and lead, and precious little coin never crosses my palm. But it's fixing to, my friend.
What do you mean?
Daniel knew it wasn't any of his business, but the stranger had opened the subject.
And packs there, they're gonna open the door. I'm gonna find out if getting rich spoils a man's shooting eye.
You need any help?
Matter of fact, I just might. Was the right man to come along.
Daniel stopped smiling, realizing his joke may have more merit than he thought.
You didn't say which way you was headed.
Seldom eyed him for a moment in silence.
Was headed for your house to find out if your kind mother would like some fresh venison.
Daniel took that as a sign that the subject was closed, and he didn't press it. But as he rode, he glanced back at those big packs, jouncing along on the quick-footed Mexican mules. He noted the easy, almost slouchy way Seldom rode, as if he'd been hatched in a horse barn. But if his riding was slouchy, his gray eyes were searching.
Ain't nothing you gotta watch out for. Last Indian trouble we had was several years ago. Just a little bunch. Hunting for horses, mostly.
Them Indians ain't dissolved off the face of the earth, friend Provost. Just because there's more settlement now than there used to be don't mean they won't show up again. More settlement means more horses. Indian, he always has a powerful want for more horses.
I'll bet you fought Indians.
Ain't we all? Fought Mexicans, fought outlaws, fought bears and cougars, fought sin, too. Life's an eternal struggle for the right thinking and the true believer.
You sound like a preacher.
I ain't. But now and again, when I find somebody in need of the word, I carry it to them the way it's been carried to me. Figure I owe it to folks to pass on the blessing I've received. You strike me as being a good, true Christian, Mr. Provost.
Name's Daniel. I've read the book, Never done no hard studying on it, though.
Man don't have to study it. It's all around him. And the blue sky, and the green hills full of game, and the running streams and the rivers full of fish. The Lord's work is all around us, plainer than words in a book. Ain't everybody can read a book, but anybody can see the Lord's good work.
That led Daniel to wonder if Seldom could even read. Lots of people couldn't. There wasn't a great call for reading in this country anyway. Long as a man could do a few ciphers and plow a straight furrow and sight down a barrel, they would have to get up awful early to starve him to death. It was often said that Texas was overrun with lawyers and bookish people. What it needed was men who knew how to build something and bring in food and fiber. The educated folk were considered like scavengers who took secondhand what someone else's labor had wrought.
The Indians is part of God's work too, I guess.
Put here to test us. The good Lord gave us the gun to shoot him with.
I reckon.
Seldom studied Daniel's brown mule and the tangle of harness.
You don't carry a gun to the field with you?
Last 3 or 4 years ain't been no need. The only fellas we ever see anymore on wild turkeys.
Seldom gave him a look that plainly said he doubted a farmer was apt to be much of a shot anyway. Daniel took this as a challenge.
You mind if I try a shot with that old long rifle of yours?
Seldom stared at him in doubt.
Old Betsy's a shade contrary.
It was fashion for Texans to name their rifles after the one David Crockett had carried into the Alamo.
Keep in mind that she bears a hair to the left.
He poured powder into the pan and handed the rifle to Daniel as Daniel slid off the mule. Daniel picked a dead limb on a lightning-struck live oak 50 yards away and dropped to one knee. The pan flashed, and the rifle shoved hard against his shoulder, and the limb splintered and fell. Seldom's eyes flickered in surprise.
You ain't always been a farmer.
Daniel had, but he let the statement stand. The provost home was a big double log cabin. Aaron and Rebecca Provost had taken literally the biblical injunction to be fruitful and multiply. Daniel was the eldest of a considerable brood, old enough now to take up his own land, if ever he could raise the money it took to put in a claim. Aaron Provost watched with interest by the open door of the long log barn. He stood 6 feet tall and more, shoulders broad, tough hands each the size of a cured ham. He could lift a wagon while someone fitted a wheel, or he could throw a bull yearling to its side and hold it down by sheer muscle and weight. He could have broken a man's neck with one blow of a huge fist if he were so inclined, but Daniel had never seen his father strike a man in anger. Provost was a friendly bear. Aaron's eyes were boldly curious as he watched Milo Seldom, but he addressed himself to his son.
Well, you're in early, ain't you, Daniel?
Brought a visitor for supper, Papa.
So I see.
Milo Seldom winced a little at the crush of Aaron Provost's hand. The big farmer didn't realize his own strength.
Name's Aaron Provost. You make yourself at home here, friend.
Seldom rubbed his throbbing hand.
Much obliged, Mr. Provost. Brung meat for the table. Don't like to be a cost to nobody.
Oh, visitors always a gain around here, not a cost. Daniel, see you after your stock, I'll take you up to the house to meet Rebecca. She'll be tickled that there's somebody come.
Any special way I ought to handle them packs?
Daniel hoped this would prompt Seldom to tell what was in them.
I just throwed him over the fences, all right. Nothing air can bust or leak out.
Aaron swung the deer carcass over his shoulder as if it had been a rabbit. He started walking toward the house with Seldom, but turned.
Daniel, you want to wash up and slick your hair before you come in? Lisbeth's here.
Daniel looked at the dusty patched clothes he wore and wished there was some way for him to change. But he owned only 2 pairs of breeches and 3 homespun shirts. Lisbeth Wills was used to seeing men come in from the fields. Her father and brothers were farmers like the provosts. And if she and Daniel married, this was the way she would see him the rest of her life. She'd just as well get accustomed to it. Normally, the thought of Lisbeth being here would crowd everything else from his mind. It did something to him he never quite understood to put his arm around her when nobody was looking, and to feel the quick, shy response as she leaned to him. Sometimes she put something sweet-smelling on her neck. He never did know what it was, and it got him to breathing hard and thinking things he would be ashamed to tell her about. He was not naive. He knew exactly what this sort of thing eventually led to. though he had never so far let himself go beyond a furtive pinch or two where he had no business. Lisbeth always slapped his hand gently to let him know he shouldn't, but never stingingly enough to make him retreat altogether. She let him know without saying so that once the proper ceremonies had been attended to, he would be welcome. The stranger was heavier on his mind now, however, than Lisbeth. Tomorrow, Milo Seldon would ride out with hardly a backward glance, while Lisbeth would be here forever. He struggled to lift the heavy packs from the mules and hang them on the fence as she approached.
How do, Daniel?
Lisbeth Wills was tiny. He could almost reach around her waist with his two hands. This had caused Rebecca Provost to worry aloud that she might not be strong enough to attend to all of a woman's work, though Daniel had noticed that the Mexican women of the Hernandez place upriver were small and seemed to have an unbounded capacity for labor. Daniel had never fancied the chunky or the big raw bone type of girls anyway. There were a few of them in the valley if his preference had run in that direction. Tiny or not, Lisbeth could cause him about all the excitement he was able to restrain.
Afternoon, Lisbeth.
Daniel glanced toward the house, saw nobody looking, and gave her a quick promissory kiss. She touched him with both hands, then pulled back, remembering herself.
Supper will be ready directly. Your mama is frying up venison from the deer the stranger brought in. I already helped with the bread.
She was forever reminding him she could cook.
What did you think of him, Lisbeth?
Not very fat, but he'll make passable venison.
I don't mean the deer. I mean Milo Seldon.
Didn't pay much attention to him. He's another rolling stone without no moss on him. I like to see a little moss.
Don't he make you itch to know the places he's been to? The things he's seen?
Why? I'm not interested in going any place. I like it here.
Sure, this place is all right, but...
He broke off, knowing he couldn't explain it to her. It was a woman's nature to be a nest builder, to cling to what she knew. She couldn't know the way a man's eyes lifted to the horizon sometimes, the way a man's nature strained to shake the bonds and cross over the unknown hills.
I'll go with you in a minute, soon as I get through here. Will you wait?
You know I'll always wait.
The venison was good. Rebecca Provost had fixed fresh bread from wheat Aaron Provost had carried way over east to the flour mill. Milo Seldon wolfed food as if he hadn't eaten in a week. And perhaps he hadn't. A drifting man usually carried coffee and salt and little else, depending upon game for whatever sustenance he got. But even venison cooked on a spit over an open fire could become tiresome after a while. A woman's touch was probably a treat indeed. Daniel noticed that Seldon gave Lisbeth much of his attention. Not that he tried to talk with her much, but simply that his eyes seemed always to stray back to her. Daniel supposed this ought to bother him, but somehow it didn't. It seemed confirmation of his own good judgment in latching on to Lisbeth himself. Later, when supper was done and Aaron and Daniel and Seldon repaired outside to the brush arbor to cool themselves in the spring breeze, Seldon pointed his chin toward the door.
Might have combed a little girl, that one yonder. She spoke for?
Sort of.
Smart of you, friend Daniel. A man needs a good woman if he's got him a place and gonna stay put.
Ain't got me a place of my own. Maybe someday if I can raise the money.
Daniel's 12-year-old brother, Log, came out and flopped down on the ground to stare at the bewhiskered Milo Seldon in flagrant and unapologetic curiosity.
And what is a fine, strapping young fellow like yourself boring yourself with all these oldies for?
Log smiled big. Seldon's acknowledgement of his maturity won him friendship for life. Seldon looked toward the cabin again.
Always wish for a little woman like that myself, only I'm always on the move. And a man can't ask a woman to follow along after him like a pet dog. Indian woman, maybe. Or even a Mexican. But white women ain't made that way. Sort of brings me up short and reminds me of my shortcomings when I see a woman like yours. You're lucky.
Am I? Must be something to get to come and go when you please, stay where you want to, move on when the notion strikes you, to see new country all the time?
The restless foot. I've always had it. Been both a blessing and a curse to me. A blessing when I see somebody who's worked himself into the ground on one little place for years and got no more to show for it than I have. A curse when I see a pretty little woman and know I can't ever have one like her. Just an occasional night or so of sinful pleasure in one of the settlements, bought the way a man buys a bar of lead or a little parcel of powder. But I can't change my ways. They're settled too deep in me, even if I wanted to get shed of them. Be content that you ain't got my roving nature, friend.
How do I know I haven't? I've never tried.
Aaron Provost got out his old pipe and the leather pouch in which he carried his tobacco. Seldom blinked as if he had just thought of something.
Where'd you get the tobacco, Mr. Provost?
San Felipe. Was down there on some land business with the government. You like to smoke?
Seldom pushed to his feet.
Put it back in the pouch. I bet I got something you'll like better.
He strode to the barn. In a few minutes, he was back, carrying a huge handful of leaf tobacco.
Try that. Bet you ain't had the like of this in years. Fine, burly, prime stuff, if prime was ever growed.
Aaron Provost smelled of it, and his mustache lifted in a broad smile.
Oh, why, Swan, lad, you are most certainly right.
Aaron eagerly went to the dog run between the cabins and made use of the tobacco shredder mounted there, then filled his pipe, lighted it, and drew on it, eyes closed in pleasure.
Oh, land of Goshen, how this takes me back.
Daniel knew now the aroma he had smelled earlier.
You mean that's what you got in them packs, is tobacco?
I'm not just tobacco, friend. Pure gold. I'm on my way down to Mexico to sell it. Them Mexicans will need to give you gold ounce for ounce in trade for that kind of prime tobacco.
I hear they got a mighty stiff tariff on it.
Tariffs is for them that don't know the Mexican ways.
You fixing to smuggle it in?
Daniel remembered an old rascal named Noonan, who used to neighbor them here, and who had told of smuggling tobacco into Mexico long before the big war with Santa Ana.
Ain't nothing sinful about a little smuggling. Border lines is a thing of man, and contrary to all the laws of God and nature.
Aaron Provost's eyes were open again, and he was close to a frown.
Well, there's talk we may be moving toward another war with Mexico. You reckon a man ought to be going down there under them circumstances, selling stuff to people who may be fighting us again one day?
I fought in the last war, Mr. Provost. And if it comes to that, I'll fight in the next one. But maybe there don't need to be no war if people understand one another. And what's a better way to learn that than by trade? I say set up trade with a man, and you don't have to have a war with him.
Well, now that depends on how you trade.
Better trading than fighting.
Daniel remembered what Seldom had said about standing on the threshold of wealth.
Even granting that tobacco is worth a lot in Mexico, I can't see much wealth in three packs of burley.
Now, the tobacco's just the starting place. It's to give me money enough that I can go where the real riches are.
And where's that?
Another man's business is best left alone, lad.
Milo Seldom studied the boy a while as the women joined the group.
No harm done, Mr. Provost. I see no reason I shouldn't tell you. There's no harm you good folks would do to me. You remember Jim Bowie?
Him that died in the Alamo? He'll always be remembered in this part of the country.
You ever heard about his lost silver mine?
Daniel's backside began to prickle.
There was always talk that he found an old Spanish mine. Nobody ever knew where or even if there was truth in it.
Oh, he found it. Way to the west, out in the middle of that Comanche and Lipan Apache country. Wasn't far from where the Spaniards built their fort on the San Saba and left it a long time ago. He found it, then lost it. With what I get out of this tobacco, I'm gonna find it again.
You'll find your grave is all. There's Indians out yonder in that western country thicker than hair on a buffalo hide.
But there's silver, too, and I'll have my share of that. And the world will stop and tip its hat to Milo Seldom.
Daniel suspected nobody ever paid much attention to Seldom, and that probably rankled him. Come to think of it, he told himself, outside of family and a few friends, there ain't nobody heard of Daniel Provost. Rebecca Provost, a gaunt and patient woman, nodded knowingly, for she had heard many a dream spoken in words, but had seen few lived out in deed. Lisbeth Wills listened with mouth open. She hadn't been around half as long as Rebecca.
Every man to his own brand of religion, I always say, and seeking after riches is a religion to some. But the silver I want is right here on my own ground in reach of my plow. Comes up fresh with every planting when the Lord sees fit to send the rain and withhold the pestilence.
And a good life it is, too, brother, for them as has the gift of living. But the Lord turned me another way, and who am I to deny him? I'll see you after my stock before I roll out my bedding. I want to rise early and be off in the cool of the morning.
Not without a good breakfast to give you strength.
Oh, I wouldn't think of it, good lady. Cooking such as yours is a blessing that comes rare to a man of my nature.
He bowed and walked to the barn. Lisbeth watched with eyes showing awe.
Strange man. Scares me a little.
Nothing strange about him. We've seen many like him back in Tennessee, and there's plenty of them in Texas. Backwoodsmen, men of restless foot, akin to the wild creatures that migrate with the seasons. There ain't no mystery to them. They're just men that ain't ever found their way.
Idlers. Likeable some of them, but idlers and misfits. They raise no crops, build no cabins. They move across the country like Indians. They contribute nothing and leave no sign.
They contribute. They're the first ones into every new land. They're the ones that test the mettle of it and learn its ways. They open it up for the farmers and the others that sit down roots. God made all kinds of men, and for every kind there's a reason.
You reckon he does know how to find Jim Bowie's mine?
Oh, that's a dream, that's all. But he knows how to hunt for it, and to some men, the hunt is more important than the finding.
Invited to spend the night with the provost boys in the loft over the cabin's open dog run, Milo Seldom politely declined, indicating he'd rather sleep out by the barn than be a disturbance to anybody. Lisbeth Wills stayed over and would sleep among the provost girls, and as usual on such occasions, she and Daniel took a short walk hand in hand past the garden and down to the stock well and back toward the house. Also, as usual, Lisbeth did all the talking. Most times, Daniel would listen contentedly, enjoying the music of her voice and the exuberance of her dreams. But tonight, he heard only a little of it here and there. His mind was on the stranger who rested out by the corrals. The stranger and the three packs of tobacco and the exciting times that must surely lie ahead of Milo Seldom.
Some other girl got you thinking?
Been studying on that Milo Seldom and the things he said. Been thinking on what a farm I could buy if I had me a share of that Jim Bowie silver.
He's crazy even talking about it, and you're crazy listening to him.
It's enough to set a man's mind a-running. All that silver out yonder waiting for somebody.
You'll find yours, Daniel, where your daddy found his. In the crops that come up out of your own ground.
But that's painful slow. A man gets in a hurry sometimes.
I'm not impatient, Daniel. I ain't pushing you.
It's me that's impatient.
Her hand squeezed his fingers, and she leaned against him.
There's time.
When she stirred him like that, he didn't know if there was time or not. It was customary for everybody to be up and about by first light, for the day was never long enough to do all the work that needed doing. But Daniel quietly climbed down from the loft, even earlier than usual. He moved uncertainly toward the barn, half afraid Milo Seldom might have taken a wandering notion and be already gone. To his relief, he saw the tobacco pack still slung across the fence, and the pack mules and horse hobbled on grass, awaiting time to be on the move. Lod came trotting along barefoot, tugging at his breeches.
Get back in the house, Lod!
Lod gave no sign he understood Daniel's word or gesture. Daniel decided to try to ignore him. Milo Seldom was awake and dressed, if indeed he had ever taken his buckskins off. Daniel figured he probably had slept in everything except perhaps the heavy boots and the Mexican hat.
Morning, brothers.
Seldom greeted Daniel and Lod, sitting on his single blanket and scratching first his head, then his backside.
Women folks ain't already got breakfast, have they?
It was still dark, and no candlelight yet showed through the open windows.
Not yet. They'll be up directly.
And I reckon I'll be packing my mules and be ready. The early miles are the easiest. Late in the day, a mile is hard won.
I'll help you.
Daniel took down a rawhide riata the Mexicans had taught him to use, for he suspected from the wild look that they carried about them that Seldom's horse and mules might be mean to catch. But Seldom waved the rope aside.
I just leave not spoil them none. Fella uses the rope a few too many times. He can't catch them without it no more.
Seldom approached them with the bridle and halters.
Come on now. You know what the Bible says about hard work and faithfulness, and the penalties of sloth.
In a minute, he had all four properly caught and the hobbles removed.
When God gave man dominion over the beasts of the field, he meant him to use it with kindness and firmness.
Lod scurried around getting in the way, but Daniel knew something about packing mules and was able to help Seldon. He pointed this out in an oblique way.
I reckon it takes you a while when you ain't got no help.
Time means mighty little to a mule.
It can mean a right smart to a man.
I trust the good Lord to give me time for what needs to be done.
The Lord gave Seldon time to put away breakfast, the likes of which even Big Aaron Provost seldom ate.
Ma'am, missus, I'd like to thank you for your kind attention and good cooking.
It's been a pleasure having company. And don't forget the extra corn dodgers for the way.
Rebecca handed him the sack. Daniel hoped Seldon would tie them where they wouldn't get taken up with the flavor of horse sweat.
I'll remember you good folks when the weather turns cold and rainy, and it'll bring a little sunshine to warm my soul.
Daniel followed him out to the horse and the pack mules, itching with the things he should already have said.
Mr. Seldon, you'll be needing help on this thing you're doing.
Seldon frowned, sensing the rest of it.
I got some people down the way that I expect to be willing to go with me.
You got one right here that's more than willing.
Seldon looked him full in the eye, regret in his expression.
Been thinking you'd say that, and been wondering how I could answer you without causing bad feelings to either one of us. You ain't the kind, Daniel. Now, maybe you think you are, but you ain't. You was born for farming and tending stock and for raising babies with some pretty little corn-fed girl like the one I seen here.
Farming is not a soft life. I know a plenty about hardship.
But of another kind. A man can stand hardship when he's on land that he knows, when he's got his own people around him, when he knows where he's gonna lay his head down come dark. It takes another breed of man to stand hardship where he don't know no landmark, don't have no friend, don't know if he'll live to see the sun come up. I'd be doing you a wrong in the eyes of the Lord was I to let you go with me and you not meant for the kind of trouble we'd ride into.
He tried a weak smile that didn't work and reached out to grip Daniel's hand.
Now you best stay home, friend Daniel. This is a growing country. Texas needs farmers a heap sight more than it needs tobacco merchants and treasure hunters. A man like me don't leave nothing but tracks. A man like you leaves the land better than he found it.
Seldon gave Daniel no chance to argue. He swung easily up into the saddle, waved his hand in a broad motion meant for everybody, and rode away in a brisk trot, leading the Mexican mules. Daniel's throat was tight with frustration as he watched Seldon move out across the rolling green prairie. At length, he was aware of Lod standing beside him, eyes shining in admiration of Milo Seldon.
You know something, Daniel? When I'm old enough, I'm gonna get me a horse and some pack mules, and I'm just gonna travel the country the way he does.
The only mules you and me will ever handle is plow mules.
Daniel turned away, knowing it was time to harness Hezekiah. Daniel tried not to dwell upon his disappointment. He went to the field and attacked the plowing with an angry drive he hadn't had in a long time.
Move, Hez!
Daniel finished more plowing in less time than he had done all year. He saw the mule's ears point forward and head go up in sudden interest, and he looked. Over the hill came two men on horseback, strangers.
Traffic sure has got heavy here of late.
Daniel wiped sweat with his sleeve and licked dry lips as he thought of the water jug waiting in the shade. He finished the row and left Hez standing, while he went for the water and waited for the men to reach him. He decided right off he didn't like their looks. Neither was inclined to show friendliness. If anything, they were suspicious.
You! Come here!
The man was tall, with a badly worn beaver hat and a swallow-tailed coat which hung down on either side of the saddle. The command roused a stubborn streak in Daniel.
If he wants to talk, he can come to me.
Daniel stayed where he was and took another drink.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.